All right, so I think we'll begin. Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to introduce myself and welcome you to this afternoon's webinar entitled New Frontiers in Family Mediation. This webinar is one of the series of webinars addressing topics aligned with the Negotiation and Conflict Resolution Master's Program at Columbia University School of Professional Studies. My name is Andy Hummer, an advisor in the School of Professional Studies, and I will be facilitating some of our conversations today. I encourage you to utilize the Q&A function box as you develop questions during the presentation. At the end of today's session, we will be addressing some of the questions you share with us. We will not be using the chat box function for this webinar, so please let us know of any questions via the Q&A box. I would also like to share with the group that today's session is being recorded and will be made available to you for your convenience. At this time, I'd like to welcome today's presenter. Joining us today is Dr. Beth Fisher-Yoshida, Academic Director for the MS in Negotiation and Conflict Resolution Program. Along with Dr. Beth Fisher-Yoshida, we have Ms. Catherine Grace Hannibal, who is an attorney mediator with Mediation Works Incorporated, adjunct professor at CUNY School of Law, and president of the Family and Divorce Mediation Council of Greater New York. Hello, Beth and Catherine. How are you today?
Hi, Andy. Thank you. Hi, Catherine.
Hi, doing well.
Great. Okay, so we can get started in looking at New Frontiers in Family Mediation. So if you can please go to the next slide. In order to set the context, I want us to think about family as a system. And in the NECR program and elsewhere, we look at something called dynamical systems. And that really, in essence, is just that there are a lot of different factors that influence what happens in a system. And that the system is dynamical, meaning that it is self-organizing and that there's always some kind of movement and there are different kind of reinforcers or inhibitors that happen in the system. So for the first bullet point, we'll see that different factors in a system are interconnected. And if it's an open system, it just means that there are lots of different ways of variations to happen to the system. And this is important when we think about intervening in any kind of family dynamic that is a system, because all of the members or stakeholders inside of that family system are directly, indirectly interconnected with one another. And the second bullet point, we see here that there are complex layers. So when we have issues in a system, any kind of conflict, any kind of level, it starts out as something that might be considered or perceived as a very simple, straightforward, linear type of conflict. However, because there are so many relationships inside of the system and inside of the family, this can quickly become very complex and very layered because there is history. So you have this relational history between people. So every new interaction is just another layer adding on to either reinforcing or dispelling the kind of relationship that existed before. So it's not as straightforward as only resolving that particular issue. In the third bullet point, we can see that inside of our families, we all have different roles that we play and scripts that we follow. And sometimes these are roles or scripts that we have designed by ourselves. And a lot of other times they are roles and scripts that have been influenced by others around us. So I just want to give a brief example. In my former career, before I became involved in the field of conflict resolution and negotiation, I was a special education specialist working with children with learning and emotional problems. And in my work in situations such as that, sometimes we had little Johnny, for example, who had a learning problem or a behavioral problem in school. And I was called in to assess Johnny's situation to determine, did Johnny really have a learning problem, or was Johnny exhibiting a learning and behavioral problem because of something else happening? So I worked with a team of specialists, and there were also family systems specialists on the team. And I was called in to diagnose that, and we wanted to know, did Johnny have the learning problem, or in some situations, Johnny had the problem because it kept his parents focused on his problem and took them away from the conflict between the parents. So here you have a system of three, but again, those are the people I worked with directly, but then there were many other people in their system. And so we needed to know in that system, where was the real issue? There's the presenting issue, of Johnny's problem, but underneath that, we realize that the root cause of that is not that he had a learning issue, is that he was trying to be the safeguard of the family system and keep mom and dad together. So that, you can see, has very complex layers of relationship in there. And the fourth bullet point I'd like to talk about, Kate, can just, yeah, there you go, is really now, once we understand the system and we understand more about the relationships between the different actors or stakeholders in the system and how their dynamics work with each other, we can identify the points of intervention. What are those leverage points going to be where we can really start to affect a change in the dynamics happening in the system so that we can create a healthier dynamic? And this is really just setting the context and understanding family as a dynamical system to lay the groundwork for what Catherine's going to talk about now in her work. Catherine?
Thank you, Beth. So I think what's extremely helpful about that introduction is because, well, systems is one aspect of psychology and psychological knowledge. And so one thing to point out is, and I'll talk about this a little bit when I draw on some wisdom from Ken Cloke later when I'm talking about mediation to stay married, but one thing to recognize is that psychology and this kind of knowledge really very much impacts mediation and conflict resolution. In fact, there's a very blurry line between the two, but particularly for family mediation, for all kinds of work with families, this curiosity at the very least, even if one is not therapeutically trained or has, you know, no formal, you know, advanced degree in some sort of psychology, to have exposure and to be able to work with colleagues who have this kind of expertise, and to, like I said, continually build upon your knowledge base, be curious about, and have some facility and ease of working with this and some natural aptitude for this is really, really crucial for any kind of family mediation work that one does. So let me just open up the discussion agenda by talking about what we're going to be walking through in the next 30 minutes or so and then having some discussion about. I want to define family mediation, and I feel that Beth's introduction there was really helpful in some ways, kind of fleshed that out a little bit better even than the definition. But the definition was customized somewhat for, I would say, separation, divorce, but it really has global applicability to every single field that we see, not only the established practices that are continually evolving, and I'll talk about that in a little bit, ways in which established practices like separation and divorce mediation, which is how I was trained and what I've been doing for the last 10 years, are continuing to innovate so that they can help families more effectively. But it really has general applicability too to the evolving, to the new practices. These are things that we've discovered maybe 10 years ago and may not really be in common use, or we haven't really defined them as field practice areas that, you know, clients have found us for. But they're very exciting because they have great potential. And I'll be talking about what those practice areas are, one of which I am working in now. I have a few active cases in which I'm going to want to talk about a little bit. And then I imagine that some of the folks joining us on the webinar today might have some interest in getting involved in a career that, you know, where they can build on their family mediation skills and offer their services. So we can spend a little bit of time talking about how do you access this? How do you train and how do you, network and build bridges so that you can truly become a participant and help us actually carry the field forward. So I want to first talk about what I've been doing a lot of work with basically since I graduated law school in the last 10 years. I've been working primarily in separation and divorce mediation, and a big part of the reason for that is that I was invited to join an established practitioner here in the city, who had already been doing this for 12 years, so she's quite a visionary. She's one of the few in the beginning, now we're quite common. And so that's what I ended up stepping into. And then there's a close relative to that, which is collaborative family law, and that's really under the purview of attorneys. So not necessarily everybody's a mediator who does that work, but certainly you have to be an attorney, and everyone tries to get collaboratively trained to truly be practicing collaborative law. We'll just touch on that briefly because it's not really mediation, but it's very close. And then I've been doing a good bit of prenuptial, postnuptial mediation, as well as review as an attorney for people who are in the mediation process. Then we'll get into the more some of the interesting ways in which some of these areas are evolving. For instance, I've been doing a lot of training and talking about child-centered mediation within separation and divorce. And then we're going to get into some of the really juicy stuff, some of the newest practice areas that we're pushing out into the marketplace. And hopefully, you know, I think clients are starting to see the value in those areas, but we'll get into that next. I want to just backtrack for a second and talk briefly about a definition. Again, this was probably developed with broad applicability in mind, but I'm sure that because separation divorce was kind of one of the first things that came into being in the last, you know, 20, 30 years, and which really found its niche, I think they had probably separation divorce mediation in mind. And so basically what you're seeing here, and for anybody who's had seminar work or training or exposure to conflict resolution ideas, right, we have this idea of a facilitative approach, right? We have an impartial, neutral third party. Every one of my colleagues who do the work I do, they're not evaluative, right? So we're all working impartially. And, you know, we're there to basically promote the conversation. You know, those of us working in separation and divorce, we're there to provide legal information, especially those of us who are attorneys. And the lion's share of us, well, I would say a good number of us, are attorney mediators working in separation and divorce with families. We're there to provide legal information. We're there also to help them get across the finish line. We're conflict resolution specialists. So we want to make sure that we're promoting communication. We're providing structure for their conversations. We're promoting constructive conflict, right? And we want to also make sure that everyone is having a chance to express themselves, that we're deepening understanding of everyone's interests, values, needs, when needed, really being able to allow people an opportunity to express their feelings. They can be quite powerful. With the idea that, of course, we're not going to be making any decisions like a judge, as everyone probably listening into this webinar knows, right, as a mediator, our role is really to get them, once we have deepened and developed the conversation, get them to explore those options, make decisions, and if we're talking about divorce, decisions for their settlement, and then reach agreements. And of course, we know as mediators practicing broadly, agreements can be verbal, they can be contracts. And specifically within separation and divorce, what we have are separation or settlement agreements that eventually, if the clients decide to go that last step and dissolve their marriage, will become part of their uncontested divorce. It becomes part of their settlement that the court refers to when granting the divorce. So, what one thing to just point out though with that definition is, as I've said a couple times already, when we start to march through the newer areas, you'll see that really that definition is apropos for pretty much any kind of family mediation work that one undertakes. And of course, there's differences. There might be process differences, different number of people participating, different kinds of agreements and different outcomes. But the idea is that's all the same kind of technique work that one is doing. So let's just talk about separation and divorce mediation for a while, and why has it become so dominant? Really nationally, I think that it's really taken hold, and it's become for many people the first stop if they're exploring a separation and divorce option. But certainly in hotbeds like California and New York and Florida, other places like that, it really is quite dominant. And I think part of the reason for this, there are several qualities to separation divorce mediation that really work well. First of all, with the marketplace. So particularly within the area of law, because you really have to interact with the law in order to obtain a separation divorce, particularly the divorce, right? So There's a set outcome with predictable process. There tends to be a manageable number of players. At a minimum, it just takes two spouses and a mediator. And it's been a great specialization for attorneys. I found when I first started doing the work, I could be quite effective as a generalist mediator just out of law school who had some family law work and who had the, you know, ability to observe an established practitioner who had at least 12 years of, you know, legal practice under her belt. But I did become more effective after a couple of years when I had more facility with the legal concepts and more knowledge. So having a knowledge base of matrimonial law has been very helpful. And that's why you see a lot of attorney mediators. You also see a good number of therapist mediators who hand things off to the attorneys when it comes time to get technical, draft the separation agreement, file the divorce. Therapists can't do that, but they can take the couple all the way through their decision-making on the aspects of their settlement. So I think the other reason that it's really taken root is that, you know, divorce has become more common. It's no longer seen as a catastrophic life-ending event, but a life transition for a lot of people and for a lot of families. And so not to say that it's not difficult, but I think we have a much more resilient understanding of divorce now. And so often spouses, you know, are not necessarily looking to blow each other up. There's not always a really extreme reason for them, their decision to go separate ways. Even if it's a painful decision, difficult decision, they're often looking for holistic solutions. They want each person, each member of the family to be okay to a degree. Now, obviously you're looking out for yourself to some extent when you're going through something that's this difficult, but typically there is a sense that they want everybody in the family, the reconstituted family, to make out all right. You know, again, often people are not acrimonious when they come to our office. They sometimes are, but often they're not. And so they want the tone of the process to mirror those needs. If they're able to sit down at the kitchen table and chat in between sessions, make decisions themselves, we promote that. We don't need them to go into their corners with their separate counsel and go and do all out war. There are always going to be some cases that require that kind of intervention and help, and that's okay. But I think, again, the fact that we don't need to overcomplicate it or make it adversarial when it's not by nature, I think that that's what a lot of clients really seek out. It's difficult enough as it is kind of the idea. And then there's also a goal of conserving assets. You know, when you take things out of court and you stop fighting, you know, you're getting out of that universe where each attorney, especially in New York, is charging a $20,000 to $25,000 retainer just to get started. And, you know, depending on how complex or simple the issues are in a divorce mediation, you could actually get through a whole process, I would say, for under $10,000. And that's nothing to shake a stick at. That's still a lot of money. But when you contrast that against the tens of thousands of what people will typically have to spend in a court process, even if they don't go to trial, you can see that money is really going back to the clients, it's going back to their children. And that's what people have in mind constantly when they seek out mediation, and also when they weigh the importance of staying in the process and compromising and developing creative solutions rather than just sort of staking a position and getting out and going to court. Often, and this is something that I'll touch on when I get into child-centered mediation, they want to preserve the relationship with their children. They see that the better experience a child can have when they're going through an already, you know, huge transition as a family, the more resilient they'll be. Children are very resilient, and they can make out well, but to the extent that you can have a more peaceful, thoughtful process, again, child-centered, I think that new area within this established area that I'm going to get to in a second really promotes that even more. You're going to want to do that. So I want to say that oftentimes when people think of family mediation, why do I spend so much time talking about this? Separation and divorce comes to mind because it's made the biggest impact. It's kind of at the forefront of our minds. It's in common use, and it's had huge reverberations on our culture. I think people are more creative and practical in their parenting relationships and schedules when they go through the divorce process now. No, they no longer see it as a zero-sum game, quote unquote, who gets custody, who gets the kids. But what have we been doing that works? What does everybody's schedule dictate? Dictate when it comes to the parenting schedule? What do our kids need? What if what our kids need changes? So there's a much more dynamic and flexible thought process that goes into a lot of the agreements people make now. And there's usually room to breathe and grow in these agreements that become part of the settlement over time. And we're putting more of the power back into people's hands when it comes to how do we live our lives now that we're no longer together, but we're still a family. Less acrimony has resulted in better mental health and better relationships overall. More and more, we have an emphasis on mental health and well-being in our culture, which is a very welcome thing. And that certainly, probably there's an interplay there with, you know, separation and divorce mediation. Some of the ideas and result, you know, outcomes of that field have probably impacted this, our sense of well-being, and vice versa. There's really dynamic interplay there. Agreements are more likely to be followed when you develop them in separation and divorce mediation. And that's been proven, for example, with a 12-year longitudinal study launched by Robert Emery, who is a professor out of UVA and was publishing on a lot of these, the benefits of divorce mediation at a time when there really wasn't too much out there. And his longitudinal study was extremely helpful and had been cited from, you know, a lot when it came out. I remember when I was graduating and going into this field, there was a lot of buzz about it. And in fact, a lot of my colleagues and I put his Children's Bill of Rights in the parenting section of our agreements, which was extremely helpful guideline for parents in recognizing the needs of their children. Overall, and this is something I can touch on very briefly when I talk about child-centered mediation, both parents tend to have more contact with their children, particularly fathers. People are being thoughtful about how they collaborate, as I said before, particularly on parenting schedules. And that whole every other Saturday and Wednesday dinners with dad is very much an outmoded concept. I would say regionally here, at least, families tend to think presumptively more about joint schedules. But even there, you know, it's not so mechanical. It's really helpful when people draw on what works for our family, what's likely to work going forward, and what are people asking for. And so whether or not it's completely down to the second 50-50 time or it's some variation on that, what matters is what works. And so we find that when we're out of this position of it's my rights and my time, that overall both parents are having a more enhanced parenting relationship with their children, which of course has wonderful benefits and outcomes for children as they grow into adulthood. So all of those things are pluses. I'm going to actually brush over collaborative law because I see that our time is limited. But suffice it to say, it's very much the same ethos as family divorce mediation. The process is roughly the same, and the major difference is that there's two attorneys who are trained collaboratively, and they even sign a collaborative agreement with their clients with certain ground rules in place, as well as an understanding that if they're not able to settle in collaborative, that they will pull out and new, different kinds of counsel will step in, particularly if they're going to have to go more adversarial route. This particular area is fairly well recognized. It hasn't really taken root to the degree that family mediation has. There may be various financial limiters. There may be some cultural changes that need to take place, as well as the field itself needing to get on the same page about how the process is structured, which if there's time and interest, I can talk about a little bit further in the Q&A. I've also been practicing over the last 10 years, and I find that many of my colleagues who are established practitioners doing this longer than I have also been doing a good deal of prenuptial and postnuptial mediation. In fact, one of my very first cases, I was actually a review counsel for a couple doing prenuptial mediation. and so there was actually just to take a step back, no mediator in that case, but the other review or consulting attorney was mediation trained. I was mediation trained. We were both identified as mediators. And so what we were able to do is very collaboratively develop, draft, negotiate, discuss with our clients, with each other, and almost sort of, I don't think we ever did have a four-way meeting, but almost it felt as if we were having a four-way meeting virtually. We were able to put together the agreement to both parties' satisfaction. And it was a very collaborative and positive experience, I believe, for all of us. The clients wanted to work further with me on other types of matters after. I couldn't do it because there's a conflict of interest, but they were very happy with both of us and the outcome. You know, I think that people often talk about the trauma of undertaking prenup and postnup negotiations. You know, usually one spouse is coming to another spouse, or maybe they decide to do it together. There's many good reasons for developing a prenup or a postnup. I'm thinking more about prenups. I think what's hard for people is that they're very much in love, usually, when they're coming to the table to talk about a prenup. In fact, one of the things that's made me happy over the years is since I've dealt mostly with divorce and separation, I come out into the lobby and I see my clients holding hands, and it's a nice thing. But I think what ends up happening is a little bit of shock sets in when we're sitting around the table, because it almost feels unwholesome. We usually have to contemplate their divorce, their imaginary divorce, as just as they're getting ready to bring their lives together, because in order to suss out what's important to each of them, you know, we need to figure out, well, how would you organize things and divide things in the event that you weren't going to be staying together, right? So what I mean by this is a lot of the logic of the way a prenuptial agreement functions is it's meant to make it easier on both people if there's a separation and divorce event, and that it organizes the assets and debts of the marriage and other types of items in a way so that they can just sort of execute and get it done almost mechanically without having to then sit down and negotiate. So that's a plus, but the problem is you have to get deep into that narrative of not staying together, and that can be difficult. Perfect role for a mediator to normalize, also to get kind of under, you know, the sort of request items they're coming in with, to understand kind of why they're asking. Sometimes these are things that don't necessarily have to be captured in a prenup, but just need to be aired, you know, or talked about. And sometimes they do, but just to be able to kind of urge a deeper understanding between the fiancés, rather than have them in their corners negotiating through attorneys or hiding behind attorneys, has tended to result in better agreements and a more positive experience with the process. There's also, both for prenups and postnups, it tends to be that if it's not to organize how things would go in a separation divorce event, sometimes it is to protect inheritance. Either someone's coming in with an inheritance from their family, or they want to make sure that assets for their children from a prior marriage, for example, are protected. So there's ways of carving that out and doing that. And I have, you know, I've actually worked on postnups and prenups that have addressed both types of inheritance questions. So again, very, very good fit for mediation. All right, now I'm anxious to get to the evolving established practices. I can't believe I'm already running out of time. You could really spend a few hours talking about all of this, but I'm gonna actually not talk about court mandated presumptive divorce mediation. Perhaps we can address it in the Q&A. I just wanna point out that I believe part of the success in the private sector of divorce mediation has impacted the court's thinking. The courts recognize now, and some states like New Jersey were there more than 10 years ago on this, and New York has always been flirting with it, been trying to figure out ways to implement it, been aware, been discussing, but just now we are seeing a huge sea change in the last few months, and we have a push to set up more court-mandated presumptive mediation generally. For example, for civil cases throughout the state, you're going to see that. But in boroughs like Kings, they're setting up a presumptive divorce mediation panel. So it's going to become kind of the first interface for a lot of people who have filed their divorces. And I think the exposure to the process, whether or not the couple really is suited, and also the primature of the court, the authority of the court sort of recognizing the effectiveness of this type of intervention and urging people to try it first is going to continue to push it forward as sort of the go-to. So let's talk about child-centered mediation, which also, I think that one of the first developers of this approach, Jennifer McIntosh, who's in Australia, she coined child-inclusive. I tend to shy away from that only because so many people get confused. They often think the child sitting at the table negotiating with their parents, which for many reasons would probably not be a good idea. But that's not what she did in her research. What she did was develop a way for giving the children a sounding board with a person who is not either parent, just to talk about the experience of going through the transition of the divorce. Because as Beth pointed out, you know, we're not just talking about two people. Yes, they are the ones who are dissolving the union and the relationship, but particularly if they have children, you know, there's a living system, right? And every single member of that family is impacted and has an experience that shapes them. And so research has borne out, including Jennifer McIntosh's, but other respected researchers have shown that children having a chance to have a sounding board, a place where they can talk and express themselves, has a net positive effect both on the children and on the process. They don't even have to take their insights or views into the table and share them with the into the mediation room and share them with the parents. Just having that has been positive from a mental health perspective. But what you can do also for families who want to have a child-centered approach is in the therapist, and this is usually a therapist, a person who's been trained in and not only works with children, but has been trained in how to work with children in this context in a safe way that's age appropriate, depending on when the child's coming to them, right? They have the ability to share some of the insights that they've obtained from the child with the parents when it comes to adjustments they can make to their parenting communication, adjustments they can make to their parenting schedules. So this kind of approach has, I can't get into the research now, but if you go to Jennifer McIntosh's website and you click on her publications, you'll see that the gains that Robert Emery was able to identify, you know, back when he did his longitudinal study of mediation versus litigation, right? What we've been seeing from researchers like Jennifer McIntosh and Yasnick and Graham, who are very much on the same page with McIntosh, is that having a child-centered approach has enhanced further the benefits that you get from mediation, both for children and families, for parenting schedules. Yasnick and Graham are pretty remarkable in that they have also developed something called the continuum, where they help, I've actually trained, I've done McIntosh's training, I've done Yasnick and Graham's training. And what's interesting about them is that they developed a manual to help you assess on your own. Certainly you can consult with them if you need to, but assess what level the family's at and what type of intervention would be appropriate. Do you even speak with the child? Are the parents or one or both parents capable of receiving feedback? And so, and also for non-therapists, they have developed techniques and strategies that you can use actually with the parents to kind of tease out and help them in their work. To be receptive to the needs of their children, and again, to achieve those outcomes I was talking about. So it's really quite empowering, the kind of the value of what they put in our hands with the manual, with the trainings, and with this continuum model. I just can't say enough good things about it. And some of my colleagues who are attorney mediators who are not therapeutically trained have used some of these techniques and to great benefit in their cases. So this is an area that's developing. I'm part of a professional affiliation now of colleagues of all stripes who are talking about this on their websites and promoting it. I talk about it with every single couple who comes through my door. And the result is if they're not doing child-centered in that traditional sense that I just talked about, they are usually reaching out to the therapists on my network roster and trying to get their kids connected with them, or talking about how do we talk to our children about, you know, about the fact that we're separating, and really leaning harder on therapeutic support, because I feel in my work, especially separation, divorce, really in every area, that collaboration with psychologists is really crucial. We're running out of time. I will say that the elder and adult family mediation, trust and estates mediation are extremely exciting areas. They tend to be multi-party. So that's a whole skill in and of itself. I was actually trained in elder and adult family mediation. There's a wonderful group. There's great trainers everywhere, but a particularly fantastic group in Massachusetts called Elder Decisions. And they wrote a book some time ago called Mom Always Liked You Best. And basically, they walked us through geriatric care issues. Trust and estates issues actually show up a lot in elder and adult family mediation. I don't have really a chance to talk about that now. Maybe in Q&A we can talk about it. Quality of life issues. And really, actually, when it comes down to it, a lot of the issues can really exist not with the elder person who's negotiating end of life decisions and quality of life questions and legal questions, but also the adult children. That I think 50-50, really, the focus tends to be on both. Oftentimes there's a lot of infighting among siblings and power grabs and very unresolved issues from you know, the family system itself, right? Exists in a certain way, and certain things haven't had a chance to resolve. And so a lot of issues can come up with mom and dad's care. And you know, when the adult family members, adult siblings are drawn together to try to quote unquote work together in ways that maybe they've never successfully worked together before. So that's a very interesting area. Trust and estates mediation is even more in its nascency than elder and adult. I have some colleagues who are successfully doing elder and adult family mediation. It's still very rare. Trust and estates is not even happening. There was a pilot program 10 years ago when I was still at my alma mater, where the faculty of the Kukin program were actually called in to mediate some cases, trust and estates court cases. The judge there had received training and was a huge proponent. And unfortunately, that program ended with the judge's, I believe, retirement. So we really need advocates to try to push this into the marketplace, but it's a huge, huge untapped area. And so people are getting trained in elder and adult. People are not even getting trained in trust and estates. And one thing I want to mention is there's a great article I just found to prepare for this talk. It's called Mediation as an Alternative to Estate Litigation. It was in the New York Law Journal, January 4th, 2019. And it's a summary of how it can help people effectively address the many non-legal issues that show up in trust and estates that make or break these cases sometimes. Oftentimes, I believe there were two attorneys who authored it. Oftentimes, it's really just a chance to vent that people need, family members need, in order to resolve some of the issues that brought them into court. If I have just another couple of minutes, and I don't want to eat too much into the Q&A time, I want to just point out mediation to stay married, which is a fairly new area. A lot of my colleagues are offering it. I don't know how many of us are doing it. I would really like to take a survey. I was actually trained 10 years ago. There's a wonderful practitioner in Boston named Laurie Israel, who also has a lot of tax and trust and estates expertise, and she had been doing a lot of mediation to stay married cases in the Boston area, a lot of which seem to, I don't want to speak too broadly about what she, you know, what her, you know, her case composition was, but from what she shared with us at the time, financial issues were coming up that were really getting in the way of a lot of couples' happiness. And so she would try to mediate those and did very successfully, and also ended up writing a lot of postnuptial agreements governing their financial understanding. And of course, other issues in the relationship, some less enforceable than others. But she came down and trained about 10 of us, and I got very few calls over the last 10 years. I always wanted to get more. But for whatever reason, lately, a lot of my colleagues have expressed interest in this area. I actually had a couple of them approached me recently to present on it, and I was a little shy about it because I frankly hadn't done much work in the area, but I do have a couple of live cases now. Been very, very interesting. They haven't really, yes, there are some financial aspects to one of them, but really they're more or less focused on the relationship pieces and their the conflict style of the couple. And I basically made a decision a year or two ago that I would only work in this format with a therapist co-mediator, because I felt that while I had a lot of affinity for and some understanding of psychology, without any formal training, I didn't feel that I had the depth of knowledge to really capably guide couples when we got into deeper issues of their conflict style, their conflict cycle, the systems aspect of their relationship, what drives that relationship consciously or unconsciously, as Beth sort of touched on earlier. That same family systems idea can be applied to the couple as a closed system. I wanted more information about attachment styles. I've seen a lot of people's attachment style from childhood come out in the separation and divorce area, which has been fascinating. And people are under stress. You can see that the attachment style they developed when they were younger is what's kind of more on scene. And very much so the attachment style of each spouse, you know, as it relates to their love language and ways in which they may be missing each other in the marriage, that's causing more pain and more separation between the two, is an important thing to understand. And so I've been working pretty successfully with my colleague, Bruce Berman. We've been having a really interesting time of it. It's been rewarding. We are not only doing this work together, but we're also trying to consciously build a system or model that can help us, but also hopefully maybe help other colleagues who are doing the same work. You know, so my hope is over the next year or so to really develop more of a dialogue with colleagues who are doing this, so we can all together develop more helpful systems and models for each other to guide couples. Because what I've learned from separation and divorce is, in some ways, you're really boundaried in. You know, it's a set process, beginning, middle, end. You know that divorce is the outcome if that's what they choose. But with family, with mediation to stay married, this area that I'm really excited about, you really, you're kind of working in uncharted territory. You're really trying to make it up as you go along, in part because you have to be flexible. You have to recognize each couple is unique. You have to kind of see what their particular needs are in that situation. And you have to be able to give time and energy to plumbing and deepening so that you can truly unlock and help them become aware of what's driving the conflicts, but also understand how you're guiding them forward and what the actual outcome is and when are they done, and helping them define when they're done. One way you can finish the process is you can draft a postnuptial agreement. And as attorney, I'm very comfortable with offering that. I mean, but not every couple is going to end with that. And so that's where, we've done a good bit of work together to consciously define what our system is, right? And so I wanted to actually go into this in a bit more detail, but just to run through these two slides. Again, a lot of conflict resolutions originate in psychology, and I've had a lot of people ask me, well, isn't mediation to stay married just therapy? And I always want to say, well, I have a therapist involved. There's something therapeutic going on, but not really. I think what's happening is we're using psychology and we're using conflict resolution skills to organize and structure the conversation in a way where we can hopefully get the best out of mediation and the best out of therapy that's available to us. And so how do you put that into practice? So one luminary and trailblazer in the field, Kenneth Clogue, who wrote this fantastic book, The Dance of Opposites, all about systems building and conflict resolution, wonderful. Sort of more academic approach to this whole topic, but so helpful for those of us trying to develop new areas, and responsibly so and effectively so, talks about the necessity and vitalness of psychology and mediation working together. and helping a couple that's caught in a conflict system to figure out a middle passage, right? So he talks about a middle passage that avoids the twin traps of well-intentioned, hypersensitive, mindlessly sentimental, pop psychological, superficial, endless emotional processing. So some of the dark underbelly of therapy, right? And manipulative, insensitive, hard-headed, dispassionate, emotionally disconnected, legal and logical systemic analysis, right? Which is what we think of when we think of the sort of more contract-driven, agreement-driven sort of arm's length kind of discussion, and helping them see a deeper or higher synergistic middle way that helps the couple, supports them to communicate, plan, mediate, and design themselves a conflict resolution system, not merely from the mind or the emotions, but from the heart. So what he's saying here, this is on page 166 of his book, where he's talking about mediation to stay married, or marital mediation as he refers to it. That's a guideline for the person developing the system who's trying to help the couple, but that's actually the very work that we're trying to help the couple do. We're trying to help them find a higher order conflict style to help them evolve their conflict style, which requires both individual work and collective joint work between the two of them. And you know, one last thing I'll just say about the mediation to stay married that's been very helpful, borrowing from Ken Cloke, is that you're safely in the process, both with the mediator's help, with structuring, reflecting, supporting the therapeutic interventions of the therapist, you know, and the therapist delving when needed to draw awareness to each spouse's attention to very important things that need recognition in order for the change to happen, right? What you're doing is you're guiding them to a crossroads where they can look at their relationship and say, okay, what part of this can I resolve myself, and what part of this are we able to resolve together? Does this mean that we can resolve and forgive but end the relationship? Does this mean that we can actually maintain the relationship but in a new way? And so only they can answer that question, but that's part of our work. That's the kind of the first part of our work. And then the second part of our work is becoming, as we're seeing as we do this work, is how do they want things to be now? And what is that going to look like? We know what this old, for example, conflict style is. I keep talking about conflict styles because that's what we're engaged in very much right now with one couple. What's the conflict system that's not working for you? Where does the change need to happen? How would your new conflict system look? How do you get in and into it and out of it? How do you engage in conflict more productively and responsibly? And then also, how do you build love and trust, or rebuild it, as the case may be, in this particular example with this couple? So this is very interesting work. It's very exciting to bring a lot of the conflict resolution skills I've been practicing for quite a while into this arena, and to be doing so in an interdisciplinary manner with my colleague. I realize I'm out of time. There's so much more substance I wanted to cover there, but I just wanted to kind of reiterate, family mediation is a really exciting, very dynamic field. In large part, thanks to separation and divorce mediation, it's very widely recognized. It is, as you can see from listening to the last 30 plus minutes, it's evolving and innovating. And that's because of us, the people who are doing the work. It's a big tent, meaning there's still work to go around. Come on in and get cases, and let's advance this. People need help. People need intervention, and they need people to drive these ideas into the marketplace so they have alternatives to basically court. I mean, I hate to say it, but that's pretty much where a lot of people land, and it's not really helping. You can get trained. There's actually, I can show you really quickly, beginner trainings. I got trained at the New York Peace Institute while I was still a law student at Cardozo. A lot of people do it mid-career, postgraduate. There's many great trainings to go around. I would say find these basic trainings on the John Jay listserv. Join this immediately if you haven't. It's a wonderful, wonderful information resource. Not only can you learn about basic trainings, but for family mediation, 40-hour trainings. Oftentimes these are for divorce, okay? But there are other types of trainings. Get on the listserv. Feel free to reach out to me. I'll tell you which ones I think are really great, to the extent my advice is helpful. Apprenticeships. I believe that New York Peace Institute offers one now. We actually used to offer Mediation Works, where I have been, an apprenticeship within our office to train people not only in family divorce mediation, but how to run a mediation practice. So they can launch their own practice and really work with clients meaningfully. NYPI was referring to us. And then I believe they started their own apprenticeship in-house. The person who was offering the basic divorce mediation training now offers, I believe, the advanced, Robert Collins, who also trained me at Cardozo in his clinic on divorce mediation. Private practices, I've had a number of colleagues transition from other legal fields and literally just, you know, they apprentice with an experienced attorney, they go off, they launch themselves, they network, and they've been tremendously successful. So that's a way to get a foot in the door and get real exposure to clients and to really learn how to do this. And then, of course, there's a whole alphabet soup here at the end. I can unpack what each of these organizations are, so you don't have to try to do the sleuthing work over Google. But basically, this is a great way, in the networking resources. This is how I've gotten involved. This is how I've gotten cases. I've met new people. So these are all great resources for anybody wanting to launch a career in family mediation. And that is my last slide. I hope we don't have time.
Thank you. No, Catherine, thank you so much. That was so informative and so helpful.
Wonderful.
So, So we have some questions here that I want to pay attention to. And it's from the same person. And two questions. One is, only if you need QQ. Do you consider special ed mediation to be part of family mediation? And the second question is, do you want to talk about how court-mandated mediation can be voluntary? So I'm not sure you'll only have a few minutes. Can you address both of those briefly?
Yes, I can, I believe. Now, I have little to no exposure to special needs mediation, but I have a few colleagues who actually do practice in separation and divorce, and they have special needs backgrounds, not only by training, but they happen to have a special needs child themselves. I absolutely think that in addition to being under the category of education, there is actually just a category of special education mediation. There really is. Of course, it completely overlaps with family issues and potentially really could have been added to my list of family mediation practice areas for sure. If nothing else, is interdisciplinary. Court mediation is something that it does exist. And in fact, in lieu of the presumptive court programs that are now cropping up all over New York and in the city, we have had a voluntary mediation program, particularly in the New York City courts. Again, probably since before, but definitely since I've graduated from law school in the last decade. Part of the reason for this, the voluntary, and they had a called panel for that. My colleagues, a lot of my colleagues are on those panels. I think part of the reason for the voluntary approach was, particularly in New York, the concern was that a lot of people who didn't want to be doing it were going to be forced into it, and they weren't going to be having a positive experience because it wouldn't be sort of the version that you get often when you walk into a private practice. And it was going to be still court driven under the court's timeline. And it just wasn't going to necessarily even be effective. It wasn't going to result in a settlement. And it was going to leave a bad taste in people's mouths. Now, the cynical part of me wants to say that maybe the matrimonial bar had a little bit to do with some of the opposition there. But at the same time, that's kind of the state of affairs for the last 10 years. The fact that there was anything was a positive. Certainly, I don't think anyone should be compelled to mediate. I just think that what's going on now is that you're seeing that there is such an embrace because they see the effectiveness, as I mentioned earlier in the talk, that they are thinking exposure is better than voluntary, just sort of like a general exposure. Now, nobody has to continue mediating if it's not working. You can opt out. But the idea is you have to start there. But yes, voluntary, I'm sure that's policy in other states. It has been in New York. It's starting to change now.
Great. Thank you. So I know that earlier we had a conversation, and I know you introduced yourself as attorney mediator. And I'm just curious, what is it that prompts you to also include attorney with mediator? as compared to just saying mediator?
Well, I guess I've gotten so used to doing that because it signals to clients what your expertise is, what your knowledge background is. Some clients will, again, I've worked so much in separation divorce that clients will really cherry pick the type of mediator depending on what their goals are. If they want, excuse the phrase, one-stop shopping, they want to go to a mediator, they know they can sit down and potentially with one person, you know, negotiate, draft, sign, you know, I can notarize for them at the signing, right? Like, and file, then they're gonna probably reach out to somebody like me. If they feel like maybe they might need more work on their communication, well, I do a lot of good work with communication, but they might need to anatomize a little bit what went on with the marriage, do a little bit of discernment about sort of how, what got them there, talk more deeply about their feelings as pertains to various issues that come up. You know, maybe a therapist mediator might make sense. And so really what you're hearing is the school of thought that I've been trained in and the area that I've been working in. We tend to kind of baptize ourselves attorney mediators, therapist mediators. And then of course I've got a miscellany of colleagues who are excellent, excellent mediators, family mediators who aren't either. You know, some are financially trained and they're quite effective. And I think of one or two I know who come from business backgrounds, really, who have tremendous facility with language. One is multilingual, maybe she speaks three or four languages. And so you'll have a lot of people who might be comfortable speaking French, for example, who might reach out to her. And then she'll still parlay what she needs when you get legal and when you get formal onto an attorney who can draft or file, but she'll do the lion's share of the work. So I guess that's just sort of how I identify myself.
Yeah, I think it's interesting to, because there are so many different types of mediators that it's interesting to frame it that way. And then of course, people still make their own assumptions about what that means. But
that's right.
Just another comment. I was just wondering, though, do you think it has an effect on people maybe wanting to not mediate as much as they could because it is sometimes difficult? Not that, I mean, anything about a divorce or family issues is not difficult. Yeah. But, you know, mediation can be tough sometimes on people because you need to uncover things that are not comfortable. So I'm wondering if that might say, well, I can always opt out and just, you know, litigate it or just, you know, have a lawyer and divorce.
That's right. Yeah. I think a lot of people realize that there's a back door that they can stop at any time. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of what happens in the private area is that people are very self-selecting. So almost everyone who started with me has finished. I think in one or two instances, I can think of off the top of my head, they have gone to litigation. When they've done that, it has been, Beth, for the sort of the reason you alluded to, not everybody has the equipment at that time in their life to be able to work in that way, and that's okay. And sometimes the dynamics between the two are so unproductive. Maybe one person can work in the format, another person's struggling, that really it would be, they'd be doing themselves a disservice to try to have the conversation in that way in the room. But what I found is the vast majority of people are able to do it, and that might be one of the reasons for the success of separation and divorce mediation.
Great. I mean, we could just talk forever on this,
yeah.
But we are out of time, and we do need to close the webinar. Thank you so much, Catherine. And
thank you.
Bring some closing remarks. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Yeah, and I would like to extend a big thank you to everyone for participating in our webinar this afternoon. As a reminder, this webinar was recorded and will be made available to you online. Should you have any other questions, please feel free to reach out to us and we'll be happy to provide you any additional information as needed. Thank you to our presenters today and to the rest of the Negotiation Conflict Resolution Program for sharing such a great presentation. Thank you and have a wonderful rest of your day.